items for consideration and discussion. Number one, alternative criteria for enhanced water supply, watershed protection, director of planning and community development.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, December 15th last year, the board voted to transmit our comprehensive plan update to the state of Georgia. As part of that motion, there was also reference to a town hall meeting for the service limitations. That is the next item on your agenda. The motion also included a discussion on impervious surfaces prior to that town hall meeting. That's what I'm here to talk about with you today. We have, to fulfill that request, we have two speakers here in the audience. Brian King, Engineering 303, John Malt, Crystal Screams Technology. They are prepared, the board is interested in providing an overview of water supply, watershed protection technologies with a focus on impervious surfaces. Can I call them forward?
Yes.
Gentlemen, if you want to take a seat at the table.
Thank you.
Prepared some handouts.
I'll pass it to you.
My name is John Maul. I am the CEO of Crystal Stream Technologies. Brian asked me to come today to discuss your stream protection and water quality in the county with you. And I want to let you know that I work in 172 jurisdictions around the country. We have approximately 6,000 maintenance operations under our belt, cleaning BMPs and seeing what washes off of properties. And I have to tell you that part of my news is really good news, because Forsyth County and the program that you put in place is among the best in the nation as far as protecting the waterways. There's been some discussion here about a 25% impervious limit in a basin and some other things, but I happened to be in the room when the first rules were written in Gwinnett County. Someone said, how did we come up with 4,000 milligrams per liter washing off these properties in Gwinnett, and it's 400 in Forsyth County? And the answer is we voted, because we had to do something. We needed to get the F. Wayne Hill permit in place. And this county's assumptions of what washes off of properties are actually very close to the truth. I'll explain that to you in a minute. But the reason I'm here is because what you have done, you have two or three things in place. One of them is you've adopted the Georgia Stormwater Management Manual, which is a very comprehensive plan that manages not only the types of surfaces and the amounts that are allowed. It also talks about how these are to be implemented and the maintenance procedures. And it's given a uniform approach across the state of Georgia to how these sites are assessed. That manual, along with an addition to that manual that's been adopted, as you gentlemen are probably aware, by Forsyth County, which makes the rules a little bit tougher. But the results are that you are doing more today than was envisioned by the 25% rule. Once again, having set in with Jim Scarborough and some of the other folks historically, as water quality came to Georgia under the NPDES, National Pollution Discharge Elimination System. As these rules came down and we struggled to meet them, Forsyth had the advantage of not being necessarily the first in line and learning a little bit. I have to tell you that the results of what you've done, and I've got a handout here to give you some idea. We made assumptions back then. We assumed 10 times too much material was washing off the properties in Gwinnett County. The assumptions were revised by looking at stream gauges, and in Forsyth County, you got it about right. In fact, I've got a calculation here also that shows you, based on our 6,000 cleanings, that what you believe is happening to your streams from unprotected impervious land is probably pretty darn accurate. And the fact that you need to protect it, these streams and this water source from that is very accurate. It agrees within 5% of a wide range of our numbers that have come in looking at the results in the field. But if you developed today under the Forsyth County plan, assuming, and this is what this handout is, assuming 400 milligrams per liter from unprotected pavement as is out here, and you did 1 acre of pavement and 4 acres of completely undisturbed land, the total milligrams, and I'm not trying to get too deep into math here, that would come off from that is 1 acre at 400 would be 400, of course, and 3 at 50 would be 150, for a total of 550 milligrams per liter washing off that property on average. In Forsyth County today, you are not allowed to exceed 80 milligrams per liter. So a property developed under the rules in Forsyth County would have a discharge of 320 milligrams per liter, almost twice as good as was envisioned by the 25% rule. Where that came from was it was an effort. Who picked 25%, 30%, 50%? Who could administer whether or not Forsyth had already used up the 25%, Fulton, and there could be no development in Forsyth? How would this be administered? And as those problems became evident, there was a lot of work done on this stormwater management manual. It was principally the ARC and others, but it's a very well-developed plan. I can tell you that through my experience, the rules are as strict here or stricter than anywhere in the country, and it's important. I've read through the original report. I've not seen the stream levels today as a result of your efforts here in the county. I would suspect that the levels are no worse based on what you've done. And there's another layer of protection that has come into your plans that was never envisioned in the 25% rule. That layer of protection is called 1 inch of channel bank protection. I'm sure the planning department is aware of this. In the old days, when we developed the property, we thought it was good enough to keep the flow rate, the depth of water in a ditch coming off a property constant. That was deemed treating your neighbor okay. We ignored the fact that we were putting 3 and 4 times the water off into the stream, and that the stream would suffer because it had to get wider and the channel, the banks would cave in, and Brian's an expert in stream restoration, Brian King is. But that's not been ignored by Forsyth County. It's been a tough road for developers and for financial interests to hack the rules as tough as they are here. People have gone to other counties and gone to other areas to develop. But you guys have stayed the course and protected your stream. And my part here today is to assure you that you have a superior system to what was envisioned. The law, section 391.316-01, to be specific, allows local governments to adopt alternate criteria to protect water supply watersheds. And so in my opinion, I'm certainly not a lawyer, we have, I saw Emily Dempsey in here earlier, I'm sure you can get an opinion as to this, but I think it's well-founded in law, that those who go beyond what was envisioned by this type of rule, there is provision in here for local governments to do just what you've done. There's one other piece of good news, and that is, I know the county is anticipating embracing low impact development and other procedures in a cooperative effort. We have found around the country that the economics, we've all been through the drought here and we understand how precious our water supply is. We understand now how precious our streams are and our reservoirs. The economics of low impact development are beginning to meet the cost. In other words, the potable water cost is going up. I've heard your discussions of raw water uptakes and generators and other things. And recognizing those issues and some tweaking to what you've already done is going to produce results that are going to continue to protect Big Creek and the other watersheds in Forsyth County. And I think you've done this in a way that has left you in the mainstream of growth without ignoring the needs of the land. Brian has got some other points here about what would happen to your schools and what would happen to your roads if suddenly you could take a 62-foot wide road, four-lane center turn lane road, you'd have 200 and some odd feet of right-of-way. Your driveways would be 130 feet long just to get off the right-of-way. There's a severe impact, and we all know that word sprawl. And sprawl means using up and impacting land. Even if it's 25% of the time, the land is gone. It's no longer in its natural purpose. So the smart thing to do is what you've done. Allow development, but strictly control based on the scientific principles contained here in this study, contained in your CH2M Hill study, that generated that development tool that some of you are probably familiar with. You've done a good job here in Forsyth County. So I wanted to step up and give you kind of a perspective, since we work nationwide. I'm on the EPA Peer Review Committee for MPDES. I'm on the ASTM 2770 Committee for Testing Standards. So I get to hear what's going on around the country. And here, this situation is in general a good situation. You're right to keep your eye on it. You're right to have the type of rules you have, but you're doing a good job for a second. Brian?
There's not much that I can add after John has talked, but one very simple little analysis that I did was just taking a typical lot. If we took a very typical lot for Forsyth County, it'd been 100 by 200 feet, and we imposed that 25% impervious, we couldn't develop that lot. Putting a very standard house on there with a heated square footage of 2,300 square feet, having a side entry garage, 50-foot setback, and a 50-foot right-of-way, taking half of that right-of-way and the lot, that comes up to 31.9%. So we're going to be somewhere in the, if we had a smaller footprint, we could be 28% to 35%. But we're going to be, this tells you automatically that if you impose the 25% impervious maximum, you'd have to go to larger lots, three quarters of an acre to an acre. Other things, having been in stream restoration, the main sources of pollutants that we see in our streams are sediment, and this is probably 90% of the time it's a historical problem due to poor land management practices. Providing the water quality outside the stream buffers doesn't stop sediment in the streams once the streams have become incised. What we mean by incised is where this is a stream that has lost its connection to the floodplain, and once they lose their connection to the floodplain, they try to build a wider channel. This in turn creates problems because once we get a wide and shallow channel, our water temperature raises, which provides poor habitat. Then from there, when you get a storm, the stream can't access its floodplain. And having studied under Dave Rosgen, who's recognized probably as the father of stream restoration, the floodplain is your protection zone. We use the term floodplain when talking about stream restoration as any event over a 1 to 1.2 year storm, that in turn the stream now has access to this flood area. Once it accesses the floodplain, it reduces velocity. The stream banks aren't subject to as much erosion. So if we were going to focus on something, it would really be looking at our streams and seeing if there's areas where we could restore or preserve these streams. And protection of the floodplain is probably more important than the 25% impervious and giving our streams access to the floodplains once again.
Could you, if you don't mind, go through this top sheet before you get to the end of your presentation and just hit these items?
Sure. Do you want to do that, Charlie?
Sure, if you'd like me to. I want to add one other thing that has been a good program here in the county, and I'm sure most of you are aware of it. I know if you've developed any property at all, you're certainly aware of it. The rate of sediment going to a stream during the construction process is approximately 30 times the rate of a finished site. 67 cubic yards per acre according to the state and Russell equations. That's probably pretty accurate. In fact, you have probably slightly more erodible soils in Forsyth County. So paying attention as you do to soil and erosion control, and your inspectors do a good job here on these sites. That is 30 times as critical. You can do 30 years worth of damage in 1 year of poor soil and erosion control on the site as far as the stream is concerned, as far as sediment is concerned. And one other thing I should mention, we talk about milligrams per liter solids, okay? That might not mean a lot to people. I talk in pounds per acre per year because it makes sense to me. I can understand that, okay? But those solids are not the pollutants that hurt your stream. They're not what hurts your drinking water. Solids are fairly easy to control. A stream will remove it itself in a few hundred feet most of the time. But the solids are a surrogate for other pollutants. And the theory by the EPA is, and by the way, it's a good one, we've proven that now over the last 12 years, we've learned a lot, is that if you get the solids out, you're going to do a pretty good job on the copper, the zinc, the metals, the other things that are truly detrimental to human health and to the habitat of the stream. But I think Brian can also back me up saying that sediment is the number one impact on the stream because it carries pollutants and on habitat. Just controlling the impervious, item one here, by not developing 75% of your land is certainly not going to control what goes in the stream. It will only be one quarter as much, but as I showed you my first calculation, you're actually putting more solids into the stream under that plan than if you do the strict rules, and they're very strict rules that you have now. The new impact development procedures, what some of you may not be aware of this, but this is talking about reusing the water on site, never letting it get to the stream. Substituting potable water, drinking water, for water you've recovered to flush your toilets, to water your landscape, and that sort of thing. Low impact development carries a lot of other techniques that can help your streams in a different way, and this is the direction Forsyth County is heading in, and as most of the world's heading in right now.
Yeah, rainwater harvesting becoming very popular, especially in North Carolina. Just basically hooking the downspouts from the development to rainwater. And when I say harvesting, we're talking containment of 250 to 500 gallon tanks, not a 50 gallon drum. They can be stored underground. They can be hidden by landscaping and stuff of that, and then reusing this water for irrigation.
I had looked at that earlier. We ran into an issue with, we just don't have enough time to work at it, but to come up with some credits for developments that would put those in to where those homes can use that harvested water for watering in their garden.
If the water doesn't leave the site, a good technique that's been used in a lot of jurisdictions to give 100% credit for that amount of water. That's zero pollutants leaving the site, obviously, because the water is being reused on site. You've already instituted wider stream buffers. There is, and we're not trying to educate everybody here to become a stormwater professional, but you can do nothing better for a stream than to widen the buffers. There is no better way to protect a stream, because water running over, if you let a pipe go into a stream, everything in the pipe will go into the stream. You stop that pipe 100 feet away, and you can walk across. We do this in recreational areas now. We've done it in Tennessee and all over to teach them. They'll just stop that pipe 100 feet away from the stream and have a grassed area. No styrofoam cups, no soil, no sand. You can dump a bag of builder sand into that pipe and it will never get to the stream. So it's very important. You've already done, again, the most important thing is protect those riparian, we call them riparian buffers, stream buffers. You've done that, you've widened that. The Georgia Stormwater Management Manual is an integrated system. If you read it through, volume one talks about the principles. How do you determine water quality flow? How do you make the calculations that are necessary to understand? When I say an integrated approach, I have a product that in the Georgia Stormwater Management Manual is called a limited application control. That means that your planning department can go, no thank you, we don't want you here. They don't have to even give me a reason. There are general application controls that everyone agrees work, wet ponds, swales, and some other things. And this is the level of control that's put there in that Georgia Stormwater Management Manual. It wasn't a trivial thing that you guys adopted that. It took some courage to do that when you did. And it is a not just a one-shot thing like, oh, 25% development, that's it. That's a very poor idea as far as trying to do something to protect your streams. There's no scientific data that supports that number. And I'm not trying to argue against that rule. Look, folks, we did the best we could at the time. We were trying to protect small watershed. And no one knew what the milligrams per liter was. No one knew how these controls really worked at that point. We were guessing. In fact, we copied the Rockville, Maryland manual overnight, and someone denied that once in Gwinnett County, and I showed them where Rockville was still in the manual 9 times, and they changed their PDF and reprinted it. And I'm not knocking. I mean, we had to do something. Most of your public land projects are far above the 25%. I was speaking earlier to someone associated with the school and talking about parking and talking about safe parental drop-offs and the visual angle that you need to have. You don't need bushes and trees next to that area when kids are running across the street to get to class. There's a lot that goes into the integrated site design where you can't just necessarily stop at 25%. The things that we associate with bad water quality actually come from the undeveloped, pervious land. That's where the sand and the nutrients and other things come from. The problem with impervious and why we want to control it is once it hits that pavement, you might as well put it in the stream. In the woods, the tree drops its leaves, the tree's re-nourished by those leaves as they form an organic layer, and it's a wonderful system. It's the way nature works. Put the leaves in this parking lot out here, and I guarantee you it's not going to be 48 hours in a good rainfall before they're in your stream. So you over-neutrify your streams. The real source of pollutants, however, is not those impervious surfaces per se. They're made to hold up and stand up. They're a delivery system. Your Uniform Development Code sets standards and setbacks for parking, landscaping, and you would have a challenge to rewrite that code to conform with the 25%. As far as all the setbacks and side yard setbacks and the differences, and folks who administer that rule every day in the planning department. I had an engineering business for 20 years, and I did subdivisions in Forsyth County, and it's a complex formula sometime where we ask for waivers to cut down one side yard because it's really not reasonable based on how that particular subdivision works. So for those particular reasons and the fact that you have rules in place that are superior to a 25% rule, that is why I stepped up when these folks asked me and did some of these analysis of what the situation here is in Forsyth County. I had a comment not long ago out of Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, where we put in 22 devices to protect their beaches for two things. Trash and debris doesn't look good, but they were more worried about the traffic along Highway 17 and a major spill that could close their beaches for months, similar to some of the things you've seen on the news. And we did that. But they told me they're loving that beach to death because there's 500,000 people between Front Beach Road and the waves every day in the summertime. What do we do? Protect it. And so I admire the efforts that have been done here, and I'm sure anyone who's brought forward this 25% rule to help control development has great intentions for the future of Forsyth County. There's no one here with poor intentions. I just want to give you some confidence from my point of view, from what I've seen, that you've got a good system here and it's working well. You need to stay the course and be sure that you enforce what you've got out there.
One thing I'd like to add is by adopting the 25% EPD states that if you read there, it says the impervious surface area, including all public and private structures, utilities, facilities, and the entire water supply watershed, and I say entire water supply watershed, shall be limited to 25% or existing use, whichever is greater. Well, I'm not a lawyer, but to me, there's no distinction between Forsyth County, Alpharetta, Roswell. Once that basin hits 25%, all development in that basement is shut down. So if Roswell and Alpharetta are already at 30, 35%, and Forsyth County is at 20, but the basin has hit 25, by adopting this 25% ordinance, you've already shut yourself down, even though Forsyth County is only at 19%, 20%. That same Part 5 gives you an out and says that you can use other criteria to determine control your water quality. So adopting the Georgia Stormwater Manual, and more importantly, enforcing it, is probably the best route.
Versus the 25%.
Versus the 25%. And I included some of the calculations on the last sheet about where the various different percent impervious stand based on that camp dresser study. I don't know if that study took into account the recession from 2007 on.
When was that camp dresser study done? Do you know?
It doesn't have a date. The study that I have does not have a date on it.
No, I didn't either, but I think it was 1998, if I'm not mistaken. I could be wrong about that.
That's about right. About 98.
It's, by the way, it's an excellent study. Nothing wrong with the study. In all these studies, we have to make assumptions. But they took stream measurements and paid attention to what was going on. Obviously, they walked the stream banks and looked at the reaches. They identified some of the point source areas, like I think there was a processing plant, some other things. The study was done well. And it's been used as a baseline. I've used it as a baseline to look at what I thought impacts might be going to stream. And to give you a number, gentlemen, I hate to throw numbers at you, but if we talk about 80 milligrams per liter as an assumed effluent. We just had a device studied in Highlands, North Carolina, which is 80 inches of rain a year. It's a temperate rainforest. It's the only one in the United States. Highly active stream. Same soils you guys have got here, same base material. Our effluent coming out of our system was about 18 milligrams per liter. That's fairly typical for a well-managed property. So, and if you go dig into these numbers and you want to, I'd be more than happy to do some work. I've got this notice yesterday.
That device was also in a downtown area with
yes,
impervious,
downtown Highlands,
probably
impervious,
exceeding
yes.
75%.
Yes, it was almost 100% impervious downtown. But what the point I'm trying to make is, you can do a little more and get a consultant to do a little more study here and underscore what you guys have done and show to anyone that's interested what the result of your water quality efforts have been. Personally, I think, you know, we all have our failures, and the failures in any system are the maintenance of that system. I'm sure you're aware you've incurred some work as you put a BMP out, but by definition, it's supposed to catch things. That's why I started the service company the day I started selling our device. We're the only people in the industry who did that, and I'm not trying to brag, but I'm trying to tell you, I figured if you put it out like a dumpster, it's going to fill up. Somebody better empty it. You better know the cost, and I better be able to come to Forsyth County and say, if you bought 10 of these for a road, it's going to cost you, you know, $5,000 a year to clean them, keep them clean, keep them renewed. And we have a lot of land out there that's protected by very good BMPs, wet ponds, swales, sand filters, and other things. And if I had to give you any advice other than I think you have a better plan in place than the 25% rule, the second piece of advice would be maintain what you've got and pay attention to what you've got to support your planners and what they implement, because that execution in the field means everything.
Are there any questions for our guests? Okay, I think the purpose of this was a discussion, but also to set the county up for a town hall meeting. Item two.
Is anybody interested in them doing additional studies at the town hall to share additional information at the town hall?
What kind of
Like
the
for town hall, spending your money right now.
Yeah, I didn't know if we wanted to make the same presentation there.
Well, in what format? Maybe we don't have to decide this here. Was the town hall meeting going to be? Well, they sort of
yes.
they sort of blend in and
no action to take then?
No action to take on item one.
I don't. only other thing I would add is, in addition to the CDM study, is, you know, we do have a county-wide watershed assessment. We have a watershed protection plan developed. We have a watershed improvement plan for Big Creek Basin developed in 2007, which identifies those BMPs that need to be implemented, retrofits that need to be implemented, and restoration projects. So we've done over and above, you know, what has been presented as well, and we've even moved forward with our first restoration project in Midway Park. So, you know, we concur with everything that was presented.
Well, I think what the thought process is how do we maintain the high quality we have, both protection or even increase it, and not put ourselves in a position where we have lands of basically no value to be considered a stage on questions. Policies and rules we have in place. So I think it's good that we're on this now, there's always a crisis, but I think it's something that we do need to address, because in the next 10, 15 years, we'll see a real problem.
It could be set up lawsuits by people who want to use it.
But you have to find your balance of what the BMPs and the filtering of the BMPs will allow you and what you're gaining in the percentages.
We've got to get EPA approval.
You're going to have studies to really show it, though.
It's not something that can be fixed in a moment. This is something that will take a while to. But it's good we're doing it now.
Yeah, but I just don't know, 25%. 25% sounds very arbitrary.
I would just like to have a closer percentage of reality with this filter, and with stepping out 100 feet out of grass, help filter, and such.
Would you help us with that? Any comments?
Let me say this at the risk of putting myself, overburdening myself, but let me tell you, gentlemen, part of the success of our company, and this, I'm not saying that for my company, is that we have always taken an interest in watersheds. We've always taken an interest in research. That's why I helped found the Stormwater Equipment Manufacturers Association, because we were the guys out there putting our liability on the line. Lawsuits on the line, you name it. We've never had an NOV for one of our clients, but we're exposed, but we do all this research and we don't share it. And part of our manufacturers association, SWEMA, we have a local obligation as a part of our code of ethics that to help local governments. I can't go to San Diego, although I have, and spend much time helping them assess their watershed plan, but I would be glad to assist on a strictly non-commercial, you're never going to hear my company name again unless you ask me where I work, and give you my honest assessment, point those to the right papers, the right things that have already been written and done to help you guys. If you want to improve a little bit, that's fine. We can talk about what's effective. There's always a marriage between the cost of protection, and you've seen this fought out on the national stage. But once again, you guys have jumped over 90% of the hurdles already. There's a few things you could do to improve what you're doing and to make it practical. Mostly, you need to reassure your citizens, the folks that are investing in land and business up here, that it's going to continue to be a good environment, and have perhaps my national perspective can help put you in that light and say, hey, here's the best parts about your program. Here's the things you may want to improve. I'd be glad to do that, because I'm a half hour away, more than a day's notice.
To your point about, you know, legal action, the other thing that remains, and I think some of this will be based on legal advice, is that notwithstanding everything you say, if somebody comes along and says, it says 25%, we're going to court, you know.
Absolutely.
Now, you said that the law points to some other areas and says you can do some things, and it may end up being getting to a comfort level with that as well.
And get EPD to understand, and you know, it has to be approved by EPD, and I think probably a lot of our methods are already approved by EPD, but just to package them up and understand them.
Absolutely.
What we're doing.
And I do know the language, I know the folks.
Okay, well, does anybody want to set a date for this town hall meeting?
About March 20th.
March 20th. Is that
it coincides with the Smart Road for Science monthly meeting.
All right.
That's same time. You guys up for that?
And anybody want to suggest a place? Sorry. Yeah. Bob, are you open for questions?
Sure. Do you have anything you want to add to what you've heard? Not participation, of course, but just comments, things that you want us to work
sure.
towards and look at for this January, March 20th meeting?
For the meeting or just?
Well, just in general and the meeting as we go forward. Things that you might say need to be, not say you need to be answered, but things that would concern you or your.
I would offer that perhaps you have another work session where you get an alternate set of opinions and or perhaps a slightly different perspective on the issue. I think it's a little bit simplified to equate a 25% impervious surface limitation with not developing 75% of the water of the basin. That's simply not the case. That's not the way it works.
Do you have somebody that you know?
I think we have two engineers who we could bring, and we would, you know, I guess we would retain them to provide you that perspective.
Did you do it public hearing or doing a work session?
Well, no, during a work session, so you get the same kind of feel. I would ask maybe I'd try to set that up for you in February so I can coordinate with these folks.
What's your phone?
Okay.
I think
that's fair.
Yeah. Do we want to set the public hearing for March 20th and allow this work session to occur as people can be provided, or do we want to set a time certain for both?
Let's just say that at a work session between now and mid-February.
Okay.
And we'll set March 20th. March. We need to change it.
Do I need a motion for that, the March 20th date?
You made a motion.
Oh, I'm sorry, what was
it? I don't know when I made a motion. We would go ahead and direct the clerk and county manager to set up the town hall meeting here at Forsyth County Board of Commissioners meeting room for Tuesday, the 20th of March at 7 p.m.
Would you like it in here or stay at home?
I think so.
Stay at home right now.
There.
Format similar to other town hall meetings, open house format.
Sure, open house or presentation? Both.
Okay.
Presentations and comments.
Do you have something you want to
say? Yeah, I was going to encourage the board to get a legal opinion regarding the alternate criteria because only a portion of it was quoted to you. The part that was left out was that for you to use the alternate criteria. The jurisdictions that encompass the Big Creek watershed, which are three counties and multiple municipalities, are supposed to all agree. And so, I mean, it may very well be that you're able to go ahead and do that independent of the state law. I don't know that, but I think you guys need that determination from the U.S.
We need a motion for the. You made that as a motion.
I made a motion.
Second. We have a motion and a second.
Teddy, could you repeat the motion? Oh, forgive me.
Go ahead. To have March 20th be the date for a town hall meeting in the large room out there at 7 p.m. All those, if there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That carries unanimously.